As a scholar of Greg Smith MP and the Tones' one-hit wonder, Give Us Back Our Epping Road, my life has been plagued by one question. What exactly does it mean to give us back our Epping Road?
Epping Road's now a track, and we want our three lanes back. Give us back our Epping Road. When the blue gum ceases blooming and the lane cove tunnels fuming, give us back our Epping Road.
The more I investigate, the more I begin to think that Greg Smith MP and the Tones did not fully understand the problem with Epping Road. But then I hear this moment, and I tear up a little.
Everywhere that I go, now the fumes are spreading home. Give us back our Epping Road.
Now we can assume that it means giving the road back to the locals from current cross-city car traffic, but what would that actually look like, and how could it be done? I travelled to the home of acclaimed YouTuber with 500 subscribers, Chris Topher, to find out. Welcome to Footpaths and Corner Stores. My real full name is Chris Topher. Make sure to subscribe for one less car on Epping Road.
Tell me it meet at 4 o'clock. Oh, got a bit too in character there.
So, Chris, what does it mean to give us back our Epping Road?
Well, Epping Road, especially around the bridge, currently has terrible traffic. And Give Us Back Our Epping Road refers to the want to reclaim the road from that traffic. And currently, the state government seems to think the best way to do this is by adding 2 extra lanes to Epping Road Bridge.
And you don't?
I think it's a bloody terrible idea. And to show you why, I'm going to dismantle each and every argument that the state government has put forward for widening the bridge.
Increased road capacity to meet future traffic growth and housing development. Increased road capacity does not meet future traffic growth, it actually creates it. This is a phenomenon called induced demand. Build it and they will come. And the train and the metro will easily handle the traffic growth from current development and future development. Improved road safety through the delivery of a new central median and wider lanes. Central median, good. Wider lanes, not so good. Wider lanes, kind of counterintuitively, are actually less safe than narrower lanes at a certain point. Now, this is because wider lanes means that cars can travel faster. On a road like Epping Road Bridge, where on one side of the bridge you have traffic lights, and on the other side of the bridge you have a tight corner, both of which cars should be slowing down for, you really don't want to encourage high-speed traffic. Increased cyclist and pedestrian safety through the delivery of a wider footpath and new safety screens. The safety screens could be good, especially considering how many children walk along this bridge on the way to and from school, but they're also a sign that the road itself is too dangerous. If the road wasn't incredibly dangerous, the safety screens wouldn't be necessary. When they talk about a path for cycling and pedestrians, I assume that means they're going to make the current path a shared path. According to Transport for New South Wales' own guidelines, shared paths are not suitable in locations with intersecting pedestrian and bicycle movements, such as near entrances to schools, rail interchanges, or near busy pedestrian crossings. Epping Road Bridge is en route to a railway station, and it's also home to a few busy pedestrian crossings as well. Greater access to Epping Town Centre and better integration between transport modes. More lanes will not provide better access to Epping Town Centre because the Epping Road Bridge is not the only place with a traffic bottleneck. There's actually a lot of traffic at Rawson Street as well. And more capacity on Epping Road Bridge would just funnel more cars onto Rawson Street and mean that there was worse access in the long run because of all the new traffic. Better connectivity to residential, recreational, and commercial areas within and around Epping by improving travel time for all road users.
Do we really have to go over this again?
Enhanced active transport links and access to public transport.
More traffic lanes to cross to get to the train station actually makes links to public transport worse. Reduced maintenance requirements and operational costs. More lanes means more road means more maintenance means more money, right? Indeed. Well, it seems as if Greg Smith and the Tones are not the only people confused about what it means to give us back our Epping Road. It seems the state government also doesn't fully understand it and views us simply as car drivers, despite making some vague gestures towards other road users they didn't seem to fully understand. Now, in the middle of a cost of living and climate crisis, mistaking all people, or us, or the in-group, to exclusively refer to car drivers, well, it seems as if that would have catastrophic consequences, don't you think?
Oh yeah. And you should have seen the Labour candidate for Epping's election platform. He said that widening Epping Road Bridge was the defining issue in Epping for the election, and also described development in Oatlands as threatening its way of life.
Even the more progressive part of the pro-car movement is starting to use the kind of language we would expect to see justifying an invasion of Iraq.
There's definitely an us and them approach being taken here.
How do we get back our Epping Road if widening the bridge is not the answer?
It's simple, really. Instead of inducing more car traffic onto Epping Road Bridge, what we need to do is we need to make it easy and inviting for people using more space-efficient modes of transport. Currently, it's pretty difficult and a little bit unpleasant to walk or catch the bus or cycle across Epping Road Bridge, and as a result, it means that the train station nearby doesn't really connect that well to its surroundings. All of this adds up to mean that Epping Road Bridge is terrible for driving as well, because everyone is essentially forced into a car because the current design excludes better and more space-efficient modes of transport. So the best way to improve Epping Road Bridge's capacity is not to add more car lanes, but to repurpose the existing lanes to be more efficient. The obvious first step is to add bus lanes. There are already multiple important bus routes that cross Epping Road Bridge, currently very slowly due to traffic. And there are bus lanes on Epping Road that end just before Terry's Creek in the east that should continue all the way along the bridge. The bus lanes should also continue down Beecroft Road as far as practicable, since it is a significant bus interchange with the train station where buses currently get stuck in traffic. Bus lanes are really important, especially in high traffic areas, because without them, buses get stuck in the same traffic as cars. But when a bus has its own right of way, that means that it can overtake that traffic and becomes a genuinely useful and viable way of getting around. You don't need to widen Epping Road Bridge to build a cycleway, you can just repurpose a car traffic lane. This is especially important because the stated goals of the bridge widening project are actually to provide access to local destinations like the train station and the town centre to local people, and over short distances, especially in heavy traffic, bikes are as fast, if not faster, than cars. With some genuinely safe and connected cycling infrastructure, a lot of the people that currently drive across Epping Road Bridge to go to the shops and pick up groceries, to meet people at the park, to hang out with their friends, to get their kids from school or drop their kids off, these people could replace these car trips with bike trips and get all of the benefits with none of the current dangers. I personally don't own a car and live in Epping, and I get around fine. In fact, during peak hour, I am whizzing by the cars that just are absolutely stuck in traffic going nowhere. There's a decent amount of other people doing this as well. To see how many, all you have to do is look at the bike parking near the train station. It gets a solid amount of use, but it would certainly get a lot more use if the infrastructure was safe for everybody. It's actually possible for a large amount of people to bike to the train station and then leave their bike there in a way that just isn't possible with cars. Because of this, having good bike infrastructure around a train station expands its catchment area from around a 1 kilometer walk to around a 5 kilometer bike ride. But the infrastructure needs to be genuinely high quality and connected and separated from cars so that everybody who wants to in that 5 kilometer radius can use it to get to the train station. Therefore, the Epping Road Bridge cycleway will have to connect to the cycleway that already goes along Epping Road further to the east.
The current shared path along Epping Road will also have to be untangled into a footpath and a cycleway. A cycleway will also provide a safe and quiet buffer between the footpath and the car lanes, which will make walking far more comfortable. The cycleway should also join up to nearby shopping streets in a way that also enhances the pedestrian experience. You can see here that I've completely changed the way the intersection with High Street and Bridge Street on the west side of Epping Road Bridge will work. This is because at this street crossing, it is currently super unclear that pedestrians have priority, and if you're crossing this road, it's impossible to tell which way cars will be turning, since if they're indicating left, they could either be turning into High Street or going straight onto Bridge Street. I've seen people wade through the garden bed so they can use the speed bump to cross the road. It just isn't safe crossing it here. So I've fixed these intersections by making the pedestrian crossing and cycleway set back from the bus and turning lane so that drivers approach the bike lane and pedestrian crossings at 90 degrees, which means that all parties involved get a clear idea of what everyone is intending to do and who has right of way. This will also mean that drivers entering the street have a very clear indicator that they're leaving a main road and they should slow down while driving in the shopping streets. In my design, it's also easier for cyclists to turn from the cycleway into both Bridge Street and High Street. Currently, it's not. When I ride my bike along here to get to the town centre, here's the route that I have to take. So many unnecessary, unprioritised road crossings here. Additionally, to improve the pedestrian and cycling amenity of the side streets themselves, Bridge Street and High Street should both be changed to 30 kilometers per hour instead of 50. Now the reason for this is because at 30 kilometers an hour, if you're hit by a car, there is a 10% chance that you'll die. At 50 kilometers an hour, if you're hit by a car, there is a 90% chance you'll die. That 20 kilometer an hour difference is really the difference between a street that is safe to cycle on and can be considered as part of a cycling route and a street that isn't. 30 kilometer an hour streets are also quieter, less polluted, and easier to cross for pedestrians, which are all important aspects of a good shopping street. Finally, to achieve better pedestrian access to Epping Station and Epping Town Centre, I would pedestrianise Langstone Place. Currently, no buses use it. There are clear alternative routes for taxis, and delivery vehicles can still use pedestrianised streets. So it's a no-brainer. Besides, there are some fantastic businesses along here that would really benefit from more outdoor dining and hanging out space. It's also unpleasant to be spat out of the train station and immediately be overwhelmed by car noise and fumes and have to wait at a traffic light to go anywhere. The massive allocation of space for cars here also means that there isn't much room for trees, which would cool it down on hot days. Pedestrianising Langstone Place would also mean that the bike shed could be moved closer to the train station. I would also add the missing pedestrian crossing at the Epping Road Bridge traffic lights, which would really improve access to the train station by lessening the number of times people would have to cross the road. Now these are all certainly interesting ideas in theory, Chris, but do you have any numbers for me to prove it? Anything to numerically elucidate what the actual capacity difference will be between Epping Road Bridge with more efficient modes of transport and Epping Road Bridge with two extra lanes? Well, a car lane can carry around 2,000 people.
Two lanes, per hour. That makes people that a car lane carries per hour is 1,557, and you have the amount of people the car lanes are carried. But in the widened Epping Road Bridge, 1.8 meter footpath and a 3.5 meter footpath, both of which will carry probably around 15,000 people per hour. And that means, hang on a sec, Street Mix calculates it all for me. Excellent, 37,500 people an hour.
Now let's run the numbers for the unwidened but more efficient Epping Road Bridge.
Okay, so if we have a 2 meter footpath on either side, that's 15,000 by 2 is 30,000. We have a bike lane, that's 12,000 bikes, 24,000. A bus lane can carry 10,000 people. And a driving lane, 2.9 cars per hour.
Oh wait, that's right, Street Mix can just add it all up for me. Okay, so 67,000 people an hour.
That is well over the widened Epping Road Bridge's capacity, and that isn't even taking into account the differences with pedestrian movements as well.
That truly is a sizable difference. It makes me think that I might have a shot at understanding the true meaning of the song, "Give Us Back Our Epping Road Now."
Look, while Greg Smith MP and the Tones may not have originally intended for the song to be about this, I believe what Give Us Back Our Epping Road truly means is to stop thinking about roads and places and streets in terms of cars, and start thinking about them in terms of people. Whether this is the amount of people a road can move instead of the amount of cars, or whether it is simply making places that are good for people to be in, rather than ones that focus on car amenities such as parking and high-speed travel. Thank you so much for removing the moto-normative cloud from in front of my eyes. I feel as if I can finally see now, as if the world finally makes sense. I think I know what must be done to give us back our Epping Road. I will reclaim it for the people.
You see roads as you want to see them, in the simplest terms, with the most convenient definitions. But what we found out is that each one of us is a pedestrian, a cyclist, a bus rider, a driver, and a jaywalker. Sincerely, don't you forget
about me. If you want Epping Road given back to us, that's probably not the best way to do it. What I would personally recommend is going to the New South Wales Government project page for Widening Epping Road Bridge. There, what you can do is you can contact the project team, let them know your views on the Widening Epping Road Bridge project, and also ask to be added to the mailing list, so when it opens for community consultation, you'll be notified. Another thing you can do is check out Better Streets, and even join them if you want to. The Better Streets Coalition are fighting for 30 km/h speed limits on local residential streets and in urban centres. They're fighting for 1,000 kilometres of safe cycle routes, streetscapes for local businesses, and more pedestrian crossings. I better go call an ambulance now.
If you enjoyed this video and want to support the channel, feel free to head over to my Ko-fi. I've just set it up. If you become a monthly member there, you'll get early access to videos, early access to scripts. You'll see various behind the scenes images, things like that. Considering that I'm going to be spending over a month in Broken Hill, there should be some pretty juicy behind the scenes stuff for you to check out if you become a member now. And I just want to thank all of the people who have supported the channel so far. Massive thanks to Stuart and his wife Jo, Jules, Shareth from Building Beautifully. Massive thank you to Bike Saint, who was incredibly generous. Dave, who was a reason that I created Ko-fi, because he asked me on Twitter if there was any way to support the channel. So massive, massive thank you to Dave. A massive shout out to Lucas, who became a member when I hadn't even set up any member benefits. So yeah, huge thank you to everyone who supported so far. And stay tuned for when I go to Broken Hill and live car free for 6 weeks in the town that they literally shot Mad Max 2 in.